One of the greatest things about preparing for a marriage is the marriage itself. It's not just the wedding, but it's the marriage. But one of the other perks of investing your time and money for that wedding day is the honeymoon, right? That's the day where you get to splurge for those several days. You have the right, in one sense, to invest a decent amount of money or whatever you would have so that for a certain period of time, you and your loved one can enjoy that time. And so for our wedding, we had about, I think, like 600 to 700 people. It was a massive wedding. And if we could do it over again, we probably would redo it so that's less. But that was a lot to prepare for. And so Sharon said, I got this, because she's an event coordinator by nature. I think God gave her that gift. So she took care of the majority of the wedding. So she said, I got the wedding, you get the honeymoon. You take care of the honeymoon. I'm like, babe, I got it. 2 months before, I still haven't done it. I'm not a natural planner, and so she's like, what are you doing? Let's get on it. So we started planning it together. I failed. The one thing she gave me to do, I failed. But it was an amazing honeymoon. We went to Hawaii. It's a good place to visit, but I'm not sure if it's a good place to live. But anyways, there's a couple in our church that's thinking about moving out there, and we're strongly encouraging them not to. And we visited, and we did 5 days in Maui, 4 days in Kauai, one day in the Big Island. We did a bunch of great things. We were able to take a bus up to the mountain in Maui and see the sunrise, and then bike our way down and seeing all the beautiful parts of Hawaii. We did a helicopter tour in Kauai. We snorkeled. We swam with turtles. Almost got hit by one. It was great. Why do people spend so much time, energy for the honeymoon? It's to start off your marriage in a place of rest, in a place of enjoying each other, because all the work preparing for a wedding is not of God, right? And because it's so tiring, you want to enjoy and relax for the next few days. That's what vacations are, right? We want to enjoy and rest. In one sense, you can actually say all of life is about getting to that point of resting. You work till 65 or so, so you can retire, so you can rest, right? It's what we're wired for. It's what we long for. If you've ever gone on vacation, you also know that just going on a vacation, you don't experience rest. Right? Have you ever gone on vacation and you had a good old time? You come back, you fly back, and you sit in the flight. You come home, you lie in bed, what's looming is work the next day. So what happens? All that joy and all that rest just seems to filter out, seems to spill out. And what happens? Anxiety rises quickly. We can all, I think, agree that it's one thing to physically rest. It's one thing to go to a beach and enjoy that. But it's another thing to take that rested soul back home and stay rested. In today's talk, we'll be talking about rest. It will be talking about God's design for how we are to rest. Because in your endeavor to rest, you will see that you will fail often. You will rest for a period of time. You'll physically rest, but your soul, your heart, it will never find rest until you do it God's way. Open up your Bibles to Exodus 20. Exodus 20, we're going through the Ten Commandments. And many of you are familiar with the Ten Commandments. But the way in which you may have thought about the Ten Commandments are 10 commands, 10 things you must do. And if you don't do these things, the wrath of God is on you. So it's almost like the way that you see it is as you obey the Ten Commandments, it earns your right standing with God. But that is not how you should interpret the Ten Commandments. Because if you look in Exodus 20, verse 1, the first sentence is an introduction to the Ten Commandments. And that first sentence reveals to us that the Israelites are already saved. They were enslaved. They were enslaved by the Egyptians, and God leads them out out of slavery into a relationship, and then it's in this relationship he gives us guidelines. The best way to think about it is if you do get married, you make a vow, a commitment to each other. I will love no one else but you. Why do you do that? So that you can experience love, so that you can be freed to love. And that's what the heart of this is. These are 10 commandments for freedom, freedom to love God and freedom to love each other. And that's the way in which we're going to read this next command, the fourth command about honoring, remembering the Sabbath day, verse 8. Exodus 20, verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant or your livestock or the sojourner who is within your gates. God's very clear about how extensive this command should go. Verse 11. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Isn't it so interesting? Many of you are familiar with these Ten Commandments, right? You have an idea of what they are about. Isn't it interesting that God places a command to rest as one of the top most important commands to follow? Think about that for a moment. The first one is you shall have no other gods, right? In there, you don't use his name in vain, right? In there, there's a command to honor your parents, one not to murder, that one's important, right? But in the list of all these commands, there's this. One day out of the week, remember the Sabbath. Why? How important is this command that if we're able to follow it, it actually changes our lives? Let's define the Sabbath before we get into the meat of the sermon. I don't think everyone here is familiar with what a Sabbath is. Let me define it for you. The Sabbath, is a day of soul-satisfying rest in Jesus. It's soul-satisfying rest in Jesus. Can we repeat that? Sabbath is a day of soul-satisfying rest in Jesus. If you were to understand the tone, I believe God would have spoken this, it would be of joy. It would be of excitement, not one of command that's begrudging. It's one way to say, if we were all on vacation together, imagine that we are in the beaches of, not Hawaii, but the Philippines, okay? And, let's say, okay, these are the ground rules for our vacation, okay? You can't do this, you can't do that. Let's say one of them would be, you have to go out to this part of the beach and enjoy it. The way that I could say it is this. I could say it like this. I could say, you have to go out to the beach and rest and enjoy it. You better. That's one way to say it. The other way to say it is you gotta. Or you have to go to this part of the beach because it's going to be life-changing. It's going to make or break your vacation. When God says remember the Sabbath, you may hear it as, another command. But just as a friend would say, you have to check out that restaurant because the food's so good. That's what God is saying. Remember the Sabbath. Enjoy it, for your soul rests, depends on it, the joy of enjoying God. Sabbath is a day of soul-satisfying rest in Jesus. And so with that, we want to go into now, how do we enjoy it? What does it mean to enjoy? The first thing that we're going to look into is enjoy the Sabbath to enjoy work. Enjoy the Sabbath to enjoy work. And in this, I'm saying two things if you are following with me. I'm saying you have to rest to enjoy work, right? You have to enjoy the Sabbath to enjoy work. You have to rest to enjoy work. But also what I'm saying is you have to work to enjoy the Sabbath. You have to work to enjoy rest. So the first thing, you have to rest to enjoy the work. You have to rest to enjoy the work. Just as Rihanna says, you have to work. The idea is that's how we think of the world, right? We have to work. After I get out of college, I gotta work. I may have to go to grad school. I may have to do more education. And that's the mentality that we have. This is what we're created for, to work. But then in verse 10, what does God say? But on the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord, your God. And on it, you shall not do work. You, and he's so clear, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, your livestock or the sojourner who is within your gates. God is saying very clearly, you, everyone in here, you are not just created for work, you are created for rest. And that should be good news. So as I'm saying this, if you're thinking, oh, I have to rest, there's something wrong with you, okay? This is a good command. This is something that you should delight in. But the reason for some of us we may not have an easy time receiving it is, if we're honest, it's hard to rest, right? You know you should rest, and it actually ends up being a burden because you feel like you have so much to do. When I went to seminary, I wanted to honor this command. So I did the best that I can to take one day out of my seminary experience, out of my seminary week, to make sure I just rested. I stopped studying. Because, you know, in seminary, your work is to read the Bible, right? Your work is to read theology. And so my break was to not think about theology. So it was kind of backwards. But I wanted to honor what I felt was wisdom from God. It changed my seminary experience, where I could enjoy all 4 years. I feel like I benefited so much from it. And I can say that those were some of the best years of my life. Well, soon after that, I moved out to Korea. And I worked at a church where they're known to work their pastors. They're known to work people. Good church. But it was in Korea, basically. I was talking to some pastors of the church, just sharing about my conviction about honoring God's word and taking one day off a week from ministry. As I shared this with these pastors, they chuckled. They're like, good luck. It's not going to happen in Korea. I'm like, no, it's gotta. And so I worked real hard to protect at least one day, one full day before the Lord. What's so sad is those two pastors that chuckled, they burned out. They burned out pretty quickly. One of them made wrong decisions within ministry and was basically let go because he didn't have capacity to love. The other one, he disqualified himself from ministry. He was so burnt out, he ended up doing something that he shouldn't have done and disqualified himself from ministry. At the heart of this command is protection. God wants to protect you from burnout. Because it's not easy to rest, especially in Korea. I'm not sure what it is. It's like something in the water. But it's so hard. I mean, everyone feels busy. You could be unemployed in Korea and still feel busy, if you know what I mean. It's the nature of, I think, just the culture here, the densely populated space that we reside in. And so you have to rest to enjoy work. Even if it's the work that you love, what you'll find is if you don't rest regularly, you'll start to lose joy for the work. So isn't it, God is saying you have to rest to enjoy work. But also, he's saying you have to work to enjoy rest. Because in this command, it's assumed that you work. Even though God's not saying you work, you better work, it's assumed, it's the default, you work. So God is saying in that activity of working, make sure you have time to rest. What happens if you simply don't work? You don't rest, you become restless. So if you see, you need both. You have to work, you have to give your heart and your soul, your efforts to something God-given. But in it, as you work, that's when you're able to rest. But if you don't rest well, you won't work well. So in this, what we see is you have to work, you have to rest to enjoy work, but you also have to work to enjoy rest. I want to talk about work for just a moment. The way in which you and I may view work may be very negative. You may actually think work is a result of sin. Work is a result of the fall. But if you know Genesis 1 and 2, God put Adam in the garden to work the garden before the fall. I believe in heaven there will be work. I believe heaven will be like the Garden of Eden. And in it, we will have work. What does that look like? It'll be probably somewhat similar to our world, but sinless, undefiled. It'll be a greater city, a glorious city that we will work in. And it's in this that we start to see there's dignity in your work. And I want to affirm that. The work that you do Monday through Friday, Monday through Saturday, in the evenings, there's dignity there. And not just the high-level executive positions. Not just those that have an abbreviation before your name, such as doctor, right, dentist, whatever it would be. Not just those jobs. All jobs, if it's not of sin, there's dignity there. I don't affirm that, because the way in which our subconscious will take it is only some jobs. Not my job, but that job, there's dignity in that job, a pastor. A doctor, if you're a CEO of something, there's a dignity there because you have power. But my job as a tutor, as a mother, whatever it would be, we may think there is no dignity. A church member was sharing with me about this experience where he was a part of a group. It was a class for entrepreneurs who are interested in starting up companies. The people in the class were wealthy, wealthy men who wanted to do more businesses to make more money. One time, the group had an excursion outdoors. And so the whole group was there. I think they were at an outdoor restaurant or something along those lines. And as he drove in, he noticed all the cars. And the cars were Beamers, you know, Mercedes, you know, other European cars, not Yugos, but nicer cars. As he was driving in with his Kia, he felt very self-conscious. He parks his car, kind of, you know, self-consciously walks into the area, wondering, did people see me? Did people see the car that I drove? One guy makes a beeline towards him. He's like, uh-oh, what is he going to say? Something? He's going to make fun of me? And he's like, Kia, huh? Me too. In that... What they're acknowledging is everyone else is much wealthier than we are. Let's be buddies, right? There's this sense that the other people are more dignified or more respectable or more important. Now, I want to alleviate that here in this room. You may be a stay-at-home mom. You may have left a lucrative job. You may be a spouse of someone who moved here. You moved here because your spouse got a good job. So you had to leave your career. So you may find yourselves Monday through Friday wanting to have a job to validate yourself. You may be a teacher at an international school or a tutor. I want to say that all of the work that you, there's dignity there. Don't find your value in the salary. Find your value in the work that you do, knowing that it is God-given. God has so much more for you than your job, and you have to know that. If you only define work, when we're talking about work, if you only define work right now in terms of that 9-to-5 job from Monday through Friday, you will miss out on so much more God wants to do through you. You'll always be thinking about that calling that I'm supposed to do, I'm supposed to give my life for. But all the hours outside of that, you will not be realizing how much more God wants to use you, how he wants to use you for greater purposes. Don't define work so narrowly to the 9-to-5 job, but to know that all the work that everyone does here in this room is God-honoring, God-glorifying. As important as it is for me to be a pastor and to prepare regularly for a sermon, as important as it is for a doctor to study medicine, to help cancer patients. As important as it is for a teacher to prep well so they can educate the next generation, as important as it is for that mother to sacrifice one more hour of sleep to take care of that child, all of that is God-honoring. Calvin, I think it was Calvin, who once said, a tree glorifies God better than we do. What he meant by that was a tree, just by being a tree, just by doing what it's created for, glorifies God. But in it, as we choose to rebel or whatever it is, we end up doing things for our own glory, our own sake. There's dignity in the work that you do. I want to affirm that because it's important for you to understand as you work and give, there's good that happens through it. Also, not only to enjoy the work, to enjoy the Sabbath, to enjoy work, enjoy the Sabbath by enjoying Jesus. This is the how. Enjoy the Sabbath by enjoying Jesus. This is the how. The first is what? Why do we need to do it? But this is the how. How do we enjoy the Sabbath? By enjoying Jesus. In verse 8, I want you to see this. You could translate Sabbath, that word, literally to a day of rest. So let's reread this verse with that understanding. In verse 8, remember the Sabbath. Remember the day of rest. Remember the rest day. To keep it holy. That one day you're supposed to rest, keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath, is a rest day to the Lord your God. Verse 11. But in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day, the rest day, and made it holy. In these verses, God is giving us a secret, an insight into rest. Because in it, what he's saying is there is the rest day. And you can physically rest. But that there's a difference between physically resting and soul-satisfying rest. That's what he is saying. Remember the rest day to keep it holy. You can rest physically, but keep it holy so that you don't just rest your physical body, but you rest your soul. True rest comes not from the absence of work, right? So often you think, if I just didn't have work to do, that's when I will find rest. So you take a nap and you feel refreshed for a moment. But what happens when you get that email, when you realize that deadline that you have for work? What starts to rise? Anxiety. True rest doesn't come from an absence of work. True rest comes from the absence of the pressure of work. It's when that pressure doesn't guide you. It's when the pressure isn't even felt at times. You may acknowledge it, I have that deadline, but you don't have pressure from the work that you do. The people that heard this, they were an agricultural society, meaning that the work that they did, it was farming for a majority of the people. If you're a farmer, you have to work every day. There's always something for you to do. You have to get the water. You have to plow the field. You have to reap the harvest. There's always something to be done. So the idea from these times is you work 7 days a week because you have to work 7 days a week. And what God is saying here is, yes, that's what the law of the land says. But let me show you a different way. Don't trust the way of the world, but trust in my way. For one day a week, even though you know you need to work, take a break. See what happens. And that's a challenge that God has for them. One day out of the week, rest. This command is so important, it's scattered throughout Scripture. It's from the beginning of time God ordains this. And I want you to see this, because as you understand how important it is, you will start to honor it. And as you start to honor it, you'll see life change. You'll see more joy and peace in your own heart. Because this is how God has ordained it. So often we think that we have to work to find rest. But in this, what we will see is that the Bible reverses that pattern. So as I shared before, the idea that we have right now is we've got to work for 65 years of our lives, or you know, up until 65 years old, and then we rest. That's retirement, right? Or the idea that we have is after we work so much and we earn so much, that's when we can rest. That's the idea that we have been taught. But the Bible would actually say it differently. Actually, it flips the pattern. Not work and then rest. I want you to see this. The Bible, from the very beginning, actually says rest and work out of that place of rest. And it's very different. If you know Genesis 1 and 2, God creates Adam and Eve as gardeners. But it's in that place, in the Garden of Eden, what heaven will be like, that place of rest. It's in that place of rest God calls them to work. But in this, I want you to see this too. If you know the creation story, it's in the sixth day that Adam and Eve are created. That's when humanity is made. What happens on the sixth day is when humanity is created. On the seventh day, what happens? God rested. So what's the first thing that Adam and Eve do? They rest. They spend time with the Lord. It's from the beginning God has ordained this. But because sin has cursed the work that we do, it's a lot more toilsome than it was. So we find ourselves trying to work and work and work, making sure we can make our ends meet. But throughout Scripture, again, he reveals this idea that you have to learn to trust me as your provider, not the work of your own hands. And he does this over and over and over. So even with the Israelites, before this command is given, what does he do? These people complain about the food. They want more food. So what does God provide for them? Manna, bread from heaven. In this, what does God command? On the sixth day, take double the portion, because on the seventh day, I won't give you manna. Right? Rest. He's trying to show us, and if we understand this, it changes how we approach work, it changes how we approach rest. If we're able to understand that we rest first, we trust God first, and then we work, we approach work very, very differently. And then Jesus says it best himself in Matthew 11, 28 to 30, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find, what? Rest for your souls. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Jesus is saying, I got you. Jesus is saying, I know, I created you. From the beginning of time, God has always taken care of his people over and over and over, and he wants us to know that. I planted this church about a year ago. Many of you don't know exactly how that story unfolded, but basically my wife was pregnant the year that I was praying about planting this church. And then we found that she was pregnant with twins. And so I'm thinking about, okay, I want to plant this church. I really believe God's called me to plant this church, but I have a pregnant wife pregnant with twins. So part of me is like, I got to provide. But the church plan, I don't know. Are we gonna survive it? Are we gonna make money? Are we gonna, you know, be able to be profitable in such a way that we can take care of a pastor? A lot of fears. Anyways, we both believe God was leading us to do this. Planted the church. Initially, early on, there was a brother, Stan, who had some experience with finances, and he took care of the finances of our church. And he asked me, you know, how much do you need for you to survive here in Korea? I shared with them, you know, how much I made at Onuri, and they said, we want to be able to help you in that way. So I was like, wow, great, you know. I didn't want to be a part of the decision-making for the church with money for my salary. Basically, a full year goes by, and we, for the most part, you know, Sharon and I, we've eaten every meal that we wanted to. Me and the finance team, we met up a few weeks ago, about a month ago, reevaluating the finances from the first year, trying to figure out how we can reallocate some of the money for this coming year so we can do more ministry. And one of the things that I suggested was let's actually cut my salary from $200 for about $200 a month less. As I shared it, I wanted them to be like, no, 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 you keep it, you keep it. But they said, sure. And I was like, all right, fine. I was a little bit sad. They don't know the story, so if you're hearing now. So I was a little bit sad. But I thought, you know, God will provide, you know. What's so crazy is this? So we said, starting in April, I will cut my salary $200 less. March 31st, I get an email from the church that I grew up in. And they know about the church plan. They follow on Facebook and all those things. And I've shared with them about potentially partnering together in such a way that they can even support a little old church plant. In that email, they say, you know, we thank God for all that you're doing, all that God is doing in the church. And then they say this: we want to support you $200 a month. March 31st, April is when that change happens. God provides. He's got you. He's got me. Even if it was, if I reduced my salary, God still got me. And I want you to know that God's got you. As you give yourself to Him, He will reveal more and more how He's got you. And then on the cross, what does He say? The last words that He says before He bows His head and breathes His last breath is, "It is finished." What is finished? The work of redemption. The work that our souls long for. That work is finished. And for you to be able to understand deep in your souls, the work that most matters is accomplished. And so when you come here on Sunday, the call is to rest in the fact that He's got you, He'll provide for you, and He's taking care of all your needs. The work of God, it is finished. And so the idea that God had from the very beginning is, as my people come to worship me once a week, it's this pattern. Once a week, you rest in the Lord. You're realigned in your heart. And then the rest of the week, you're working. But as you work, you get stressed. All these things happen. And the idea is for us to come together as a corporate community to worship Him. For how many of you have you come to church when you were discouraged? You may have even prayed at home, but you felt like God was being distant. But how many of you, in that moment, you come to church and a piano plays? You see someone worship. You hear the word. Something happens. You talk to a friend, and everything changes. What's happening? God is giving you soul-satisfying rest. He may have not changed your circumstances. He may have not given you a better job, but He provides for you. And that's the pattern. Every week we come here, we remind each other of the love God has for us. As we celebrate and worship, as we see that person worship, it reminds us of how good God is. That's the idea of corporate worship. I can't tell you how many times for me, when I was struggling in my own marriage, that was in corporate worship that God spoke. God said, "I got you. I'll take care of you. I'll help your marriage." This is why we make it a weekly practice. Because we need it. A weekly reminder. Enjoy the Sabbath by enjoying Jesus. One of my pastors, I love what he did. He wanted to make the Sabbath more practical for children. Because the way that we often view it is observe the Sabbath. It's like this daunting thing that we have to do. But he wanted to change the idea of we have to enjoy Him, we have to rest in Him. So what he did, what we try to do, we forget regularly, but what we try to do is, one, they take church very seriously. And so they try to show effort in trying to come to church on time, trying to show their kids about what it means to worship. What they also do on Sundays, and I love this, is they call it a double dessert day. They try to translate God's goodness in ways that a child would understand. And so if they were to have dessert normally, they would get double the dessert on Sunday. I try to connect it to this is how good God is. That pastor of mine, as he tried to honor the Lord's Day, what he tried to do is he tried to run all his errands on Saturday so that on Sunday he's not so busy running around doing things, but simply enjoying God, enjoying church, and enjoying people. And I encourage you to be more strategic of how you do it, which leads us to the last. Enjoy the Sabbath by enjoying Jesus, but also enjoy the Sabbath to enjoy people. You want to enjoy the Sabbath to enjoy people. I shared with you that the Ten Commandments are strategically set up in such a way that the first one is the entryway into understanding everything else. You shall have no other gods before me. It's that command that helps us understand all the other commands. This command, the fourth command, is actually the bridge from the first four to the last six. Once you see this, you'll start to see how important it is for us to Sabbath together. The first four are about loving God. The first four are about how do you love God? You love God by doing these things. Right? When Jesus was asked, how do you summarize? What's the greatest commandment? He says, love God, love others. That's the summary of all the commands. The first four are about loving God. The last six are about loving people. But this fourth one is the bridge between the first four and the last six. It's because as you love God, that's when you're able to love people. This idea is very simple. If you're irritable, if you're grumpy, if you're impatient, chances are you're struggling with the first four, but you're focusing on the last six, honoring your parents, not being so angry with your children or your spouse or your friend. So often you're thinking, I have to change these things. But what God is saying is the first four, when you're right with God, when you're receiving from him, it's the bridge to love your neighbor. This is strategically placed in such a way as in a weekly rhythm, as we come here for church on Sunday, as we worship together, as we are reminded of God's glory, as we let him fill our own hearts, it leads us to love. It's scientifically proven, actually. The more stress you have, the less oxytocin it develops. Oxytocin is a hormone for you to be able to love people. When you get a hug from somebody and you feel all warm and good inside, that's oxytocin. Stress, when you're worried, when you're anxious, it suppresses the oxytocin level. But when you receive God, when you are loved in community, that's when you're also able to love others. So often we try to love people simply by trying to love people. We love people simply by enjoying him and being with him. And I want you to see this one last element before we close. In verse 10, he's so clear, isn't he? But the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord. You shall not do any work. And then who does he name? You, your son, your daughter, your male servant, your female servant, your livestock, right? Your animals, your pets, right? Later on, he also talks about how the land needs to rest. The sojourner, the visitor who is with you, don't command him to work either. You all rest together. So what do you find on the Sabbath day? There's your son, there's your daughter, there's your male servant, your female. You're all there. What do? You enjoy each other. For our church, community is very, very important. After church, the families, we get together because we've got kids and we're not willing to leave the house with our kids any other day of the week. And so what we have decided is to have community groups right after church on Sunday. It makes church long, right? I get here pretty early with the community group. I end up leaving pretty late. It's really a full days of work. But in it, what I've always found is though I'm physically more tired, my soul has found soul-satisfying rest. When does it happen? In corporate worship, when we see Jesus, but also when we're in community. My application that I want to give to you is, after church today, eat. Can I do that? Eat. Sit down with somebody and really talk about life. And don't pretend like you're okay if things aren't okay. Share. Pray with each other. And you will see joy rise up within your heart in such a way that you want to love that person, but you want to love somebody else. To enjoy the Sabbath is to enjoy people. These Ten Commands, as I said before, they're not commands that will lead you into a life of restriction. It's commands for you to enjoy God and enjoy each other. If all of us are able to change that paradigm, that have that shift in that paradigm and see it differently. As you want to honor God in these commands, what you will see is a greater joy in the Lord. Still saved, regardless of what you do because of Jesus, but as you obey, as you love, you will see joy rise up within you. It's a Sabbath for joy, and that's my hope and prayer for you. Let's pray.